I want to repeat what others have said, which is what a terrific thing this is. And to thank Jerry and Mary Ann and Michael Kessler and all those who made it possible. It's great to see old friends, see new friends, see Drew's influence coming on. One of the blessings of my life, and I'm getting old, so I keep track of these things now, was having Drew as a friend, a mentor, a colleague, an ally, someone who challenged me. And beyond that, at his core, he was a believer. He was a disciple of Jesus. He was a faithful priest, a great example of a Jesuit. And so it's just such a blessing to have him. I was honored to come here to Georgetown about 10 years ago and have him again as a colleague. I've been at this for a long time in the social mission of the church, about 50 years. And one of the best things I ever did was persuade Drew to come from Notre Dame to become director of the Office of International Justice and Peace. We only had him for 7 years. America needed him. America the magazine, I guess America the country needed him too, but those were incredibly important years. Work on human rights, on war and peace, on development, on landmines, on nuclear arms and disarmament. But I would suggest, and others probably disagree, that the most groundbreaking and consequential leadership Drew provided was his critical role in demonstrating that care for God's creation was an important, integral, and essential part of Catholic social teaching and Catholic faith. Drew had powerful allies in that. Pope Francis, St. Francis is in a bad place to start. And Pope John Paul II, it really focused this in a new way. But he had obstacles, and I was one of those obstacles. I was frankly a skeptic of this. I had come into the conference and one of my mandates was to get the department to focus. And new grand initiatives were not what they had in mind. And the other thing, and I'll be blunt, I saw the environmental movement as a rich, powerful, influential, white, successful movement in American life. And what I was working on, issues of poverty and peace, and we were not rich, we were not white, we were not very powerful. And I sort of worried that there would be a diversion. And Drew turned me from a skeptic to a convert, that this is, in fact, not only an extension of Catholic social teaching, but a deepening of our faith. So in those years, Renewing the Earth was produced, and that laid a foundation for lots of other things. Walt is going to talk about the environmental justice program at the conference. One of the least appreciated efforts was the really remarkable statement of the U.S. Catholic bishops on climate change in 2001, which frankly still is relevant and ought to be listened to. We're talking about the legacy of Drew. Two people I think of the legacy. One, Dan Misla is here. The Catholic Climate Covenant came directly out of the conference, does remarkable work, sharing resources, you know, Lent, Advent, you know, First Communion, for all I know. The advocacy and is moving from words to action and helping Catholic institutions use renewable energy. The largest solar installation in the District of Columbia is on Catholic Charities property in Northeast Washington. And so that work goes on, and all the folks here are here. The other one, and this is entirely inappropriate, but Drew would love it, is that Pope Francis is part of his legacy. In that Laudato Si, placed at the center of Catholic teaching and environmental ethic, and placed at the center of an environmental ethic, care for the poor, which brought together who Drew was. So we have other people who have carried forward Drew's legacy. A remarkable panel. We're going to do this a little differently. Our little initiative here at Georgetown has a rule: no one gives a speech. We actually had the President of the United States here, and he was on a panel. That was easier than telling a couple cardinals they were not going to give a homily to start off. But we're going to have a conversation, and I want to ask each of you, quickly up front, get everybody in, how did you know or come to know Drew, and how did his leadership and work on care for creation and environmental justice impact you, shape your work, and how does it have a continuing impact on you? Let's start. Let me first introduce everybody. That was my one job, and I haven't done it. Erin is at St. Elizabeth's. She works with the Laudato Si movement. She focuses on religious responses to the environment. She is a challenging and eloquent voice for the values that bring us here. Walt is a former colleague, was at USCCB, worked with Drew and I, started the environmental justice program. He edited a book with Drew. I said at lunch, we ought to have everybody who edited a book with Drew meet and share stories. There are great stories. Patricia is at Catholic U. She's an architect. She teaches, but she also leads efforts, I don't have it in front of me, but a remarkable effort to teach and practice sustainability in how we plan and act and lead. And Bill is a theologian, also a Catholic U. At Georgetown, we practice ecumenism, two people from Catholic U. And he heads the Center on Culture and Faith there, and he also directs the Justice and Peace efforts within the Department of Theology. So, yeah. Erin, let's begin with you.
Thank you, John. It's great to be here. And I would say that this book, Show and Tell, that Walt and Father Christiansen edited, may have been the first book in my library as an ecological theologian. It was so important for bringing together sources and showing to us Catholics and us scholars that yes, the church had an ecological mission and it had magisterial sources to verify and authenticate that tradition. So this was just essential. It said what we as ecological theologians were hoping to find existed, that there were statements that bishops' conferences around the world had words to offer, that theologians could gather and write about it. Dissertations were written on the basis of this book, not mine, but important scholarly works were done. So it just brought together really important sources at a time when there seemed to be very little that was recognized. We had the 1990 statement from John Paul II, of course, but very little was known. So it was an important early text.
Yeah. Walt, you're a colleague.
Yep. Thanks, John. I'm honored to be here to pay tribute to Drew. He was a friend, a colleague. He was a spiritual director of mine for a number of years. And a close collaborator. I first met Drew at the first symposium in 1989 that the Bishops' Conference and Catholic U put on around this question of the environment. And we invited Drew, we found out his name. And he was early in, as John said, on this issue. I found that his vision, a lot of that expressed in Renewing the Earth, with the central themes there, we'll come back to that, I hope, with this document, but laid out a vision. And also, you know, being involved with him on the day-to-day program, environmental justice, connecting environment in the question and pursuit of justice. I think the Bishops' Conference had a very unique perspective on that. And it drew on his skills for interfaith and ecumenical collaboration through the National Religious Partnership for the Environment. And Drew was also two things. One, he really did love nature. Went on hikes with him, and he really knew a lot about plants and animals, and would quote poetry. Those who, Barry Lopez, Annie Dillon, and so forth, he was able to have that dexterity. And so it was in, as someone else said in one of the prior things, in his persona. And so that really affected me. He was just a great person to work with, because we did day-to-day management, along with John, of the program, which was nitty-gritty in that sense, your implementation of Renewing the Earth. So had a profound effect on me.
Yeah. Patricia and Jessica?
Yeah, thank you so much, John. Thanks for having me here. When I was invited here to the symposium, I'll be honest with you, I didn't know who Father Drew was. And when I began to research who he was, I recognized that I actually did use some of his articles in my undergraduate thesis, which as a young architect was about transition enabling, transitional facilities, and making them a lot more environmentally friendly. And I was really surprised about that coincidence. So I'm probably the novice on the panel here. But thank you so much for having me. I'm a huge fan, and I think I was before without even knowing it.
That's terrific. Bill?
Well, thank you, John. It is a great pleasure to be here at this event, honoring and celebrating Drew. I can't say, like David Hollenbach did yesterday, that I was with Drew at Woodstock in 69. But I do have long-standing connections and a kinship with him, starting with the fact that we shared a Doktormutter, the same dissertation advisor at Yale. He was about 10 years ahead of me there. And when I got there, I was very impressed by the legacy that he left there already. He and David and a couple others, as it turned out, had already published an important work on population ethics, which was a topic that I'd written my senior thesis about. And that kind of initiated a pattern where it was almost like Drew was an older brother who had done everything that I was interested in before I got there and did it better as well. He was, not long after I arrived at Catholic University in DC, drew me in with Walt into their project on environmental justice. I provided some of the teaching materials for that, and that started me off in a topic which has only become more and more central to my work, which I call today moral ecology. Of course, I was running a peace studies program, and Drew was already working in that field, so I was able to have him come speak to my classes. When I went at a certain point to engage in Catholic Mennonite dialogue at Eastern Mennonite University, it turned out that Drew had already been working in that field and was able to give me advice about it. And of course, the work on just peace and peace building and nuclear ethics that I've collaborated with him on was also a topic where he was able to draw me in and mentor me. So I'm very grateful for all of the guidance that he's shown me.
It's interesting to me, there are only some contexts when we met at Woodstock means Jesuit formation instead of something else. We should explain that to the people online. Let me go back to Walt. You and Drew were close collaborators, edited this book. You started the environmental justice program. What was distinctive about Drew's contribution? You had worked with, knew a lot of the environmental leaders and movements and organizations. What was different? What did Drew and the Catholic community add to care for the earth?
I think, you know, when I reflect on that, Drew was very, you know, we've had a lot of the panels and we've talked about ideas. And I think that was central here too. His vision, his sacramental vision of the creation, his strong promotion of the integrity of creation, but also within that framework of Catholic social teaching. I think that's what was so unique. It is really, Catholic social teaching is such a great set of principles that you can act on, and he was able to bring that to bear, I think, in a very visionary way. We had a number of scholars conferences where we tried to, the book was one of them, where we would really try to get Catholic universities and Catholic academics to say, take their skill set and begin to apply it to a new question. We have to remember, this is the early 90s. This is not something that was certainly within the church an issue that was gaining attention, as you said, you were suspicious of it, you know, to start with. And Drew, you know, when I think of a common theme for him, particularly for environment, it was the common good. He chose to do a chapter in the book. That's what he chose to do. And I have a number of his speeches that I reread for this. And so that theme of the common good, and he was able to weave that together. And I think that was a contribution on the interfaith level. I mean, I think through the partnership and others, they appreciated, if you will, the discipline of the kind of Catholic teaching, the vision, the connections. You mentioned Dan's work, this whole network and so forth. And we were able to do that through retreats with Catholic state Catholic conference people and the diocesan network, which began to build that kind of response by the church. So it wasn't just an idea. I think it was the implementation, being able to affect people at the ground level.
That's good. Thank you for that. One of the things that struck me about Drew is he thought we didn't have to invent a new religion to be serious about care for creation, that old-fashioned virtues of prudence and modesty and humility and Jesuit values of discernment and seeing God in all things. How has that sort of going deeper instead of more broadly influenced the environmental justice program, but also reflected in Laudato Si?
Yeah, if you were to take Renewing the Earth, I think, and set it right beside Laudato Si, you will see many of the same themes in both of them. And remember, this is 1991. And I think I'm always amazed when I reread Renewing the Earth at how visionary it is. And it includes all of the elements that I see in Laudato Si. I mean, Pope Francis is really gifted with some language. There's good language in there. But it also was a real call to conversion, Renewing the Earth. And they actually, toward the end, you know, it talks about appeals to teachers and scholars and all this kind of thing. So it included all those elements. But I would say they track really, really well. And again, this is 30-some years ago. So I think it's it was a great gift. I wished we could have made it, you know, known a little bit more.
Yeah. Yeah. Aaron, let me turn to you. As I said, you work in the area of religious responses in this. You're at St. Elizabeth's University. You were a former fellow at the Earth Institute at Columbia. You've written a book. You were very gracious in lifting up their book, Inspired Sustainability, Planting Seeds for Action. And you're a leader in the Laudato Si movement. Let's continue with that theme. How does religious faith inform, shape, and extend concern for the environment?
Well, I think in really significant ways that you've already alluded to. One, it takes it beyond this idea of preserving the wilderness, and yet also deepens our connection to nature. So looking beyond isolated, uninhabited wilderness, which may have been the preserve of some of the major environmental groups you're talking to concern for environmental justice, environmental racism, integral development, et cetera. At the same time, there is a truly religious recovery of the sacramental beauty of creation, of God's presence within creation, and our sense of greater than planetary beauty, cosmic spirituality, you know, connecting to God, the creator of the entire cosmos. So it's beyond wilderness, but also much more deeply integrated in it. And with that, I think, comes a celebration of our integral humanity, how we as humans are profoundly connected to nature, how we belong in it, we are part of it, our souls are renewed in it, we discover God in it.
I remember when, I think Drew brought in a number of the environmental groups early on in the process, and Bishop Malone from Youngstown, great man, said to the Sierra Club guy, how come there are no people in your calendars? And another question was, somebody said, it might have been me, frankly, said, I worry that you're worried about pesticides in the Chesapeake Bay for what it'll do to the fish, not what it does to migrant farm workers. And I think Drew had a capacity to challenge us and to challenge them. You are a challenging voice in our community. That's our assets. Those are our strengths. Where are we falling short?
Well, I think that one of our gifts as religious people, one of our powerful gifts, is that we look at the moral implications of this. And we're able to say, where have we fallen short? Where am I complicit in the environmental crisis? Where are we complicit in the environmental crisis? And that's a very powerful gift. We're open to conversion as a community. But the flip side of that is we can look at this as a privatized moral project. And it is that to a certain extent, but it is also a structural problem. We must radically change our economic structures, our social structures, our energy structures, our financial structures, our cultural structures, and we cannot allow the fossil fuel corporations to make us think this is about my private carbon footprint, mm-hmm. this is about my personal choices to recycle, and let go of their and our corporate responsibility to transform our social and our energy structures. So we can't let our habits of religious introspection and attention to personal behavior take us away from the massive societal change that we need.
Let's continue along that line. What are the kinds of changes that the religious community, the Catholic community, believers ought to be working for?
We need to revolutionize the way we power our homes, our sanctuaries, our churches, our schools. We need to look at the flows of investments to fossil fuel corporations in our endowments, in our pension funds, in our banks, et cetera. We have to, and Georgetown's been a leader in this, and we can celebrate that and look to Georgetown to continue to share its leadership decisions in those investment areas. And we need to look at the ways we can counter disinformation, because we have an industry that is professionally and skillfully committed to disinformation and polarization. At present, at the UN COP, there are 600 registered lobbyists from the fossil fuel industries participating as members in the negotiations. And those same lobbyists are present in our Congress, and their influence is present in many of our Catholic institutions as well. So we have to speak out against that disinformation and that polarization.
Yeah, you mentioned Georgetown's decision to divest. You and I talked about that. it's important to know it was students who led that effort. Mm-hmm. They would come in quoting Laudato Si, quoting St. Francis, quoting Jesuits, and part of me wanted to say, we'll see you on Sunday. I didn't. The action often rises from the bottom instead coming down from the top. Bill, Drew was a bridge builder. You're a bridge builder. Reading your resume, theology, culture, justice, peace. You have especially linked together questions of environmental concern and conflict. But before I get to that, I want to go back to my initial hesitation, which is, if you could share, why is placing care for God's creation at the center of Catholic teaching and Catholic life not a sort of trendy diversion, but a deepening of who we are and what we believe?
Well, it's funny when you put it that way, because I view the question from the opposite view. How could you not have the environment not only as the core, but really as the foundation of a kind of comprehensive ethic that takes human rights concerns, social justice concerns, but understands that they can't be separated from a much larger context in some ways of our relationship to the earth? And I don't know that Drew completely agreed with me about this, but I remarked in a chapter that I wrote for his book that he has coming out that Carol Sargent edited with him, that Laudato Si in particular exploded the tradition of Catholic social teaching, or at the very least deeply revised it by showing that you can't really consistently come to terms with problems of social justice without placing them in the deeper context that comes to be called integral ecology in that document. So I would say that the Catholic social justice tradition emerged out of a particular time and place and set of concerns. It had to do with industrialization and workers' rights. But as the concerns broaden and deepen through our knowledge of ecology, the fundamental questions shift as well, so that we should really be talking about earth ethics in the first place and social justice as a part of that rather than the other way around.
That explodes things.
That's my view. I'm not saying that was Drew's view, and I don't expect you to agree with me, but that's my response.
I don't know if we need to go there to be clear that what we had was inadequate and what we have moving toward is a fuller expression of our faith. Let me go to some of the peace and justice studies. You've done a lot of work on the ethics of war. How does environmental concern and questions of conflict intersect?
Well, I think that they're very deeply entwined. So there are all kinds of studies that show that where you have environmental degradation, the potential for conflict arises, that on the other hand, conflicts produce all kinds of environmental damage and tensions that come to play out in a cycle of violence. So I've argued for a long time that peace building, or as my colleague Marianne Love puts it, the just peace framework, really can't be separated at all from issues of environmentalism. I think that we've seen that in the process that Pope Francis has been involved in with the synod on the Amazon, for example. If you look at Laudato Si itself, it has a lot of things to say about the implications or the impact of wars on our relationship to the earth. So really, those seem to me to be two very, very closely related fields that have actually seen strong parallel developments over the last 50 years. On the one hand, you can look at a process of people like Drew leading the way in bringing environmentalism into the center of attention for the Catholic community, you see a greening of other religions, and at the same time, you've seen this development of nonviolence and a broadening of perspectives on war beyond the old just war tradition. And I think it's not an accident that those two developments have occurred in a parallel way.
Well,
John, a quick word on that. Church has a lot to say now about ecology, has a lot to say about conflict, and a lot to say about migration. If you look at, I think it's the 13th parallel, it goes through Central America, goes through parts of Africa, and around to Southeast Asia. These are all areas of high conflict, high migration. And so I think the church needs to not do it in a silo, but put these together. And I think Laudato Si, New Earth, those things provide a framework to do that. But so don't treat them isolated, you know, but together.
I said you and Drew were bridge builders. It's hard to imagine not having Drew around to sort of push us along. Where would he want us to build bridges now? And I'll start with Bill, but I would ask each of you, and then I'm gonna come back to Patricia. Where should we be building bridges now?
Well, Drew was actively involved in building all sorts of bridges. We've talked about his interreligious work over the last couple of days, Jewish-Christian dialogue, Muslim-Christian dialogue. I just mentioned his Catholic Mennonite work. He was always concerned with that. But one other area that people might not know so much about was his deep concern with building some bridges within the Catholic Church right now, which has its own divisions around the world. And I was working with Drew on a project some years ago on the historicity of morals, and he wrote a very long contribution to that project. It's you talked about stories of working with him on editing volumes. I asked him for a couple of short chapters, and I got a 100-page dissertation on theological anthropology and the signs of the times method in Catholic teaching. And it was an effort to look back over the history of recent encyclicals and the ways in which different popes have picked up on this idea from Vatican II of the signs of the times and reflected on it and developed a method for staking out developments in the tradition. And he did it in a way which could build bridges, I think, among some of the people who were in more of a John Paul II tradition and people who were looking at Francis's more pastoral approaches. So that would be one area, I think, where he would have had a lot to offer us.
Patricia, I'm gonna come back to you more specifically, but you're an example of the bridges between environment and architecture, for example. If you or the other panelists, where would Drew be wanting to build bridges now?
1.2 billion climate refugees are predicted. That's a staggering number. And in this country, refugees and migrants are already an enormous source of conflict and anger and polarization. And I don't think it's a secret that we have a need for bridge building within our church between different cultural groups within our church. And there's a lack of understanding that the climate crisis is driving refugees. So I believe we need greater understanding within the church leadership so that our pastors are empowered to preach on this topic. It was at one of your scholars' conferences that I heard a bishop from Florida say, the environment is an issue for the laity. And the laity certainly are doing the work, and they can and they should, and they're doing a wonderful job, and Dan Misla is leading thousands of them to do it. However, Florida, of all places, to put aside the environmental crisis, the laity need to be led by their clergy. Laity are not preachers in our church. And for a moral message to have weight, we look to our priests and we need to hear their homilies. And for the priests to feel, let's face it, authorized to give these messages, they need to hear from their bishops, in some cases, that it's okay to talk about the environment. So we need to build bridges throughout our church leadership for the sake of those 1.2 billion so that we become a church of compassion for the refugee. And let that vision of compassionate hospitality guide us and enliven our preaching. And it doesn't have to be hard, and we don't have to wait for Laudato Si to become integrated in the seminary curriculum. There are homily helps on the website of the Climate Catholic Covenant. Anyone can easily find it and do it tomorrow or next Sunday. So that would be my plea.
Well, Patricia?
So it might, I was sitting here thinking about that, and you know, when we started this work back in the early 90s, there was the Ecumenical Interfaith Endeavor, and I think that really helped put religion as role with ecology together in saying this is legitimate. I think we did a good job. I think that really needs renewal now at this point at the highest level. We're at a very crisis point with climate change and with biodiversity. And this is a serious, serious everything, moral issue, security issue, health for the planet and people. And I think it needs that kind of attention. Pope Francis has brought a lot of that, but we need it in this country too, a reminder of that.
Patricia, you can take a stab at that, but I'm really struck by the fact that if Drew were here, he would probably be most excited about what you're doing. He's more familiar with what the rest of us do, but you are taking Care for Creation into the architecture school. You're a professor, you lead the director, I don't even know what, MSNet-Z?
Master of Science in Net Zero Design.
Oh, and you've written about this. One of your articles is about heating, cooling, and lighting. Talk about practical.
Yeah, that was a book.
How, the story I heard is you worked with a group of people in Kurdistan to refugees needed a place to live. And to find a way to build a decent home that is environmentally sustainable, you are taking these ideas and with your students, with your work, with your writing, and with your leadership, are putting it to work in really concrete ways. How do you do that? Why do you do that?
I started doing it because there was a lack of it. Rich clients in architecture can pay for having a net zero building. A net zero building means that a building produces as much energy as it consumes so that it uses renewable resources to subsidize any type of electricity so there's not a dependency on fossil fuel. The community of typical clients for architects, especially architects in this area in Washington, D.C., can afford this. There are building codes now that regulate, the International Green Construction Code regulates the amount of energy consumption in a new building and even in an existing building. We have benchmarking rules and regulations for buildings. But there's no real ethical justification for why we're doing it, which brought me from practice as a licensed architect to Catholic University, because I was able to not hide my cross on my office desk. I could actually put it there without fearing any criticism. But furthermore, probing into Catholic social teaching and reading these amazing encyclicals that our popes have written caused me to recognize that there is already an inherent link to the premise of environmental justice in our faith, whether it has to do with people that are homeless, migrants, climate refugees, environmental racism, and even the foundation of life itself, which Laudato Si writes about very specifically. But sometimes that's forgotten in some of the conversations of bringing us to a net zero level of buildings and even society. I would say that the most important part of bridge building is the premise of this faith that we discussed and bringing it into the secular world so that when we are teaching, educating young architects, young engineers in how to design buildings, we also teach them the ethical premise and the reason why they're doing it. And it's not to make money. It's to help people. And it's to help people through the environment. And some of the bridges that I've tried to build, some of them are still being built right now, some literal and some figurative, are my work in Kurdistan, in northern Kurdistan. When I went there under the invitation of Bishop Warda, I was asked to design a home for migrants, for the refugees. Some of them were climate refugees, some of them were political refugees. My first thought was, of course, we have to make this net zero. We have to make sure that we are designing a building for those who are poor, who can't afford it, but to the same level as what's expected for someone who has money to afford a net zero building. And ironically, it's very possible and very simple. It just requires a little bit of thinking and an application of professional environmental ethics. And that's, I have other examples, but I'll yield.
Those are powerful examples. How, because you have the expertise you have, how do we need to think differently, plan differently, build differently, act differently to begin to advance the vision that Drew persuaded us is a part of who we are as Catholics?
I think this is pretty cliche, but I think it begins with a personal decision, like I think you were mentioning. But it's a personal decision not to do what you want. It's a personal decision to recognize that every action that you make has an incredible, incredible impact on the earth, hence people and population. Buildings produce over 50% of the carbon footprint in the entire world. If you consider that, you can consider architects and engineers as stewards of the built environment. But now they're doing it because it's something cliche and something traditional. The fact is that they should be doing it because of care of the common good, because of subsidiarity, because of solidarity, because some of the same precepts that we have in our Catholic faith, but that are not brought to the light of a professional execution of designing a building.
That's great. Let me ask the whole group. We've talked about what our strengths are, common good, the sacramentality of the universe, connecting the poor, care for the earth and care for the poor, the leadership of Pope Francis, some of the groups that are carrying this out. What needs to be more developed in the Catholic community in terms of our thought and our action, and what is missing?
A personal responsibility, a personal recognition, and a personal pursuit for the truth. And all of that in culmination simply means a logical recognition that every step that you make on the earth has an impact.
Bill, what needs development, what is missing?
Well, I've learned a lot about architecture and engineering working with Patricia, with her stewardship and ethics course. And practical knowledge, skills that are coupled with a kind of ethical vision is a very important capacity that we need to build up. I also think that there's much more that can be done, needs to be done in the pastoral accompaniment of people who are wrestling with the sorts of problems that we're talking about on the ground. That was part of the purpose that Drew had in his book on nuclear ethics, on speaking not just to theoretical questions or policy questions about disarmament and so on, but to the real situations of people, Catholics and other people who might work in the military or in fields that interact with problems of environmental justice, but whose livelihoods are at stake there. So that's another field, another area where we sorely miss Drew today.
That's really interesting. Patricia talked about personal responsibility and accountability. You talked about accompaniment. And I expected everybody to say structural change. I think we might get to that. What's missing? What needs more development?
So for me, what needs continual development is what I just, the name of the program, environmental justice. That there are minority peoples and who just live in floodplains. They have the least health resources. The impact on them is enormous. And so I think trying to get, in this case, local Catholic parishes, dioceses, and so forth, to really try to link up with the questions of environmental justice at the ground level. That's a big, big area that needs, in my mind, attention.
We had on one of our dialogues on environmental concerns a terrific woman, I think it was Arise, Louisiana, and I'm forgetting her name.
Sharon Levine.
It just got a big award, and they won against the energy companies and her things. And there's so many good things about that. But one of the best things for me is they got their funding from the Catholic Campaign for Human Development. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so here's a Catholic leader, doesn't have the degrees that are on this panel, but has defended her family, her neighborhood, her community, and has used our faith and the support of our church to address the health and well-being of her family and her neighbors. It's just powerful. What?
I'll say we need a vision, an urgent and complete change to our vision. First, to evangelize the church to understand that living out Matthew 25 for the sake of the climate refugees absolutely depends on climate justice and climate action, and that we are all somehow related to this. We cannot live out our mission to the poor without attending to the climate. That connection needs to be made. And then secondly, to take on the vision of the beautiful, possible, green, sustainable, healthy earth with net zero buildings, with renewable energy, with urban green spaces, with safe, healthy transit, with regenerative agriculture. It is all possible. We do not need to invent it. The models, not even the models, the actual systems exist. They need to be scaled up, they need to be chosen, they are possible. We can have this world, and it is the world that we are called to live in, a just, a beautiful world where people can live in peace together in the homeland they were born in. So,
I'd like to add one thing, if I may. I think it's also important to educate your neighbors, educate the people that you may not think that need to be educated, but not in an ostentatious way. In a more humble way, I'll give you an example. Bill and I were lecturing a couple of weeks ago on the topic of environmental justice and environmental racism, and one of my students, there was a lot of questions about it. I would even say a little bit of antagonistic questions about this. And one student even said, "Patricia, did you make up this term yourself?" And I said, "No, I didn't." And I explained what it was. Numerous times when I was explaining what it was, the answers came in the break when a student of color came up and she whispered to me, she said, "I just want to tell you that my family's from Chicago and we're experiencing this. We were a part of some of these injustices and we're experiencing this." And then she left. Another person secretly came to me, another person of color, and they said, after I presented about Mexico City and the injustices that are occurring in Mexico City with a lack of water, ironically, Mexico City was built on a wetland, But there's a lack of water through a whole series of events that occurred that were a little bit unjust. Latino woman came after him very secretly, and she said, "I just want to tell you that my family is experiencing this now." After the class, another person came to me, African-American, and said the same thing. "I just want to tell you that thank you for talking about this. I'm ashamed to say anything in class." So it's the people that have never heard of it, that have never experienced it, that are the ones who are confused. And it's the people that have experienced it, that have personal stories about it, that recognize it, but ironically, they're the ones that are afraid to talk about it. So I think education among everyone, and I would imagine that everyone in this room is educated enough and a fan enough about and serious enough about environmental stewardship. So I think it's just a matter of not being afraid to gently and humbly teach, lead through the example, and by just talking about the stories, not being afraid to speak up for those who are afraid to speak up.
I'm really struck by the responses. If you were to do an outline of next steps, vision, justice, responsibility, accompaniment. That sounds like a pretty good agenda for the future. I have lots more questions, but I figure you might have some too. So if you could indicate whether you have a question, that would be great. There are two hands up, the woman over here. Some of us are really old and hard of hearing, so if you could stand up and speak up.
I can stand here. Can you hear me?
I can.
Okay. My name is Heidi Burns. I am a complete outside observer, interested.
Welcome.
I am faculty, a retired faculty. My field is something totally different, but with lots and lots of echoes. My field is applied linguistics, and particularly now issues of language justice, of which, of course, is a lot of conversation in conjunction with migration. I was struck by your comment on saying, okay, are we talking structural issues or are we talking issues that are on the ground, so to speak? And the reason I was struck is that I attended one of the, God forbid, Hank seminars. The competition. At the end of the synodality discussion, there was a whole sequence of events on synodality. The thing that struck me was the presentation that said, while we're talking structural issues, we're really talking about a relational anthropology. And that struck me because in my own field, applied linguistics, one of the things that has been discussed extensively now over 25 years is a theoretical approach that has very real world implications of complex dynamic systems theory, which is a very, very relational way of looking at social issues. And turning now to the question you posed, what's missing, what might be more emphasized, and what might be particularly provocative to me is, we're talking environment, but we're not talking deep down the implications of evolution.
Mm-hmm.
And within Catholic conversations, the bête noire is evolution. Because of the hierarchical and philosophical approaches that have been used for defending certain kinds of theology that seemingly and I emphasize seemingly, do not allow for evolutionary thinking. And I don't think we can talk environment unless we talk evolution.
That's powerful. First of all, you're not an outsider. You're most welcome. We're happy you're here. You've deepened our discussion. Any comment, Bill?
Sure, I have some comments about that. Thanks for bringing up those questions. One of the refrains in Laudato Si is everything is related, everything is connected. And there's a very strong sense of, I think, what you're talking about in Laudato Si. Another term that's used that also addresses that is the idea of integral. Integral ecology is the model in Laudato Si, but the church also talks a lot about integral development as part of integral ecology. And within that, there's a discussion that was mentioned yesterday about integral disarmament, for example. And the idea there is that all of these issues are connected and in relationship with one another. I looked at Laudato Si and picked out a number of places where Francis talks about or alludes to what we could think of as systems theory, actually. And I think that the document is open to an evolutionary perspective when it talks about the relationships between social ecology and economic ecology and environmental ecology and so on. So I think there's development in the direction you're describing.
Document, but coming back to your comment, that's not the kind of thing you're to hear being preached in a Sunday homily.
Your comments were far more profound than this, but one of the things that struck me is Drew was absolutely a person of ideas, but he was even more a person of relationships. Most of us are here not because of an article he wrote or a statement he helped draft, but because he was our friend, he was our colleague, he was our mentor, he was our ally. And so your point of the ideas have to come with relationships, accompaniment. Dan, I think you had your hand up.
Yeah, no questions, but some comments if I could. So Dan Missler with Catholic Climate Covenant. One of the things that was mentioned, I think, almost by everybody was there's a real crisis here. I mean, the climate crisis is truly an existential crisis. And yet our leaders don't quite get that, our pastors and our bishops. So as we were thinking as an organization, how we can get bishops to embrace this more, and I think I can count on maybe two hands the number of dioceses that are really working on this issue out of 192, if you count the Eastern Rite Diocese. There's only a couple dozen that are doing this, maybe a dozen. But when we were thinking about how do bishops engage in issues, so if bishops, there's a bunch of bishops on the border that are engaged in migration issues because they're being very much impacted. There are some bishops who deal with racism very well. There are some bishops who deal with poverty very well. Very few bishops are dealing with this environmental crisis very well. Immigrants have forced bishops to deal with this. A mass shooting would force a bishop to deal with this. Every diocese has young people, and every diocese wants those young people to stay engaged with their church. So our plan at the Catholic Climate Covenant is to form through a series of retreats, a 10-week curriculum on Laudato Si, and to fund leaders, young adult leaders in dioceses to begin to build relationships. And John, you just talked about the relationships that Drew, and that's why we're all here, to build relationships with their bishops and to begin to encourage bishops to do this. And the good news is that there are a lot of very practical things that a bishop can do to go net zero, to save money, to demonstrate to the community that they care about the environment. So I think we need to find both the motivators and the practical tools to help dioceses become engaged and become successful on this issue. And so, you know, I just wanted to say that that's what we're up to. love to have your support on that. CatholicClimateCovenant.org, and you can take a look at what we're trying to do.
Another example of the remarkable work that Catholic Climate Covenant is doing. Way in the back.
Yeah, the Catholic bishops will be meeting in Baltimore soon.
This week? They're meeting today and electing their leadership as we speak.
And I assure you that there will be a political concern discussed front and center, that bishops will engage in politics, whether implicitly or explicitly. They will cause American congresspeople and senators to get elected on the issue that they will engage in implicitly or explicitly, and it's called abortion. So I think we should be talking about integral politics, because they will neglect the Holy Father's leadership on our relationship to the natural world and the destruction of the regenerative processes that the Lord has given the natural world. Yeah. They will neglect discussion about the moral imperative to not make and deploy and make ready for use weapons which will destroy the future. Yeah. They will not discuss the relationship between how we heat our homes and the increasing disparities of wealth on the planet, the privilege of the fossil fuel industries. They will discuss the issue of abortion and how to advance their political power on that issue. I think it's imperative that we talk about integral politics so that the issues that that the very future of humanity depends upon, the climate, the oceans, the rainforests, the gross disparities of wealth, the imposition of poverty on people in small island states. They're literally losing their homes. And the fact that the politicians who are blocking progress on cooperative security, common security, environmental responsibility, social justice, get elected on the issue that the Catholic bishops are advancing. I think it's despicable. I'm not saying that I disagree with the Holy See's position on abortion. I'm only saying that that we should be pushing an integral politics that includes the very virtuous, life-giving policies that the Holy Father and the Holy See has consistently had on social justice. And we have a politics of fragmentation, where all of these important issues are put on the side, and an issue that's intrinsically divisive, that's subtle and mysterious, I might add, the entry of the mystery of the divinity of the soul into form, a true mystery. But there's no mystery about the climate. We know how we're burning it. There's no mystery about poverty. There's no mystery about nuclear weapons. That's not a mystery. So I think we should be talking, have another conference talking about integral politics, another conference about how we could leverage the matters that are not mysterious. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your passion and urgency. I think there might be some responses.
I would just note that the confrontation with the life issue of the climate crisis is so unavoidable for the Filipino bishops that as a body they have divested. And this is a nation that has seen 10,000 people die in one storm. So it's clear as day that it's a life issue to the Filipino bishops.
Patricia?
Yeah, I completely agree. This is really the bridge that needs to be built within our faith. Without a question, I'm not a moral theologian. I'm just an architect, and I'm just teaching. But 2 years ago, before COVID, I got together the Sisters of Life, the Little Workers of the Sacred Heart, and three other religious orders that are very focused on life. And I talked to them about designing a net zero building that would help women in crisis pregnancies provide an option for them so that they don't need to get an abortion if they are financially destitute. And that, I was hoping that that would be a manifestation of saying we can't ignore either issue. We really, those two issues are so integral And they're so, the foundation of our faith, I'm actually not a, my husband is a political theorist, but I'm absolutely not, but I'm just so perplexed why there aren't more bridges being built by more people who are much more educated and much more invested in our faith at the top in merging these two things. Now that project is still going. You may hear about it, I don't know, whether in a positive or negative light, but ultimately, we should be providing education on both fronts together. We see it in Laudato Si. Pope Francis very clearly states in Laudato Si, it's care for our common home. It doesn't exclude humanity, but nor does it exclude the environment. I just wish that politically these were not so ironic that they're completely different issues, as if one had a priority of the other. Together they need to be integrated. I'm hoping that there could be more of a call for this integration. And I'm happy to speak with any of you afterwards about any type of connections.
It's a great example of something I was thinking, which is we talked about building bridges. We built bridges between the justice movement and the peace movement in our church. We need to build bridges between the pro-life movement and the peace, justice, and creation movement. And we have to be clear, the problem is not only with the pro-life folks, it's also with us. And I should say for myself, it is hard to build bridges in a polarized, bitter kind of politics. Integral politics in a polarized time is tough. The only thing I would add is there are several people in this room who spend day and night working on those other issues. And with the full support of Catholics and the bishops, what is missing is priority. What is missing is urgency. What is missing is passion. Nothing would threaten human life on this planet more than the use of a nuclear weapon. Mm. And we spent yesterday trying to figure out how to avoid that and how it's getting closer. Nothing threatens more lives in an ultimate sense than the fact that we might destroy the climate which supports us. There have got to be ways to build bridges, and it's very hard work. Our little initiative tries to do some of this. In our teaching, we try and do some of this, but it will be interesting. This is in some ways a turning point in American politics. Democracy itself is at stake. The anger and polarization have left us where we can't even talk to each other. Could we find a couple things that we could do together? How about lifting up poor kids? And how about caring for our common home? So we'll see. Other questions? We haven't gotten any questions yet, I'll just point out, but I'm happy with, normally when I do our things, I say you have to put your question in the form of a question. That is not true today. This is a time for discussion and dialogue, so this has been terrific. Welcome.
Hi, I'm Peter Metz, and some of you heard me yesterday. I'm from Massachusetts, Boston. Massachusetts Peace Action and Pax Christi, Massachusetts. I'm not a theoretician or a philosopher, I'm an activist. And I'm thinking, our bishops are sitting up there in Baltimore meeting these 3 days. How about we took our message about environmentalism, about nonviolence, and about dealing with nuclear weapons, how about some of us go up there and personally insist that they hear us? Either today or tomorrow. If you're interested in talking about that, I'm sitting over here at this table, and I'd like to conspire with some other people who are willing to go pound on the door.
I wish you luck. There's a whole group of people who are in place to make sure that doesn't happen, but I actually bet on Dan's strategy of getting young people to engage. As I have at it, we need everybody. This is all hands on deck. The stakes of these issues are so high that the sort of divisions over tactics, priorities, style, even language. We need to get our act together, or what is already tough is going to become impossible.
Yeah, I'd just like to add, too, that you know, since Vatican II, the role of the laity has become more and more prominent. I think it's becoming more prominent. And so I don't always turn to, quote, church leaders for, you know, why don't they do this? I think we just have to keep moving forward, engage them as much as we can. I love Dan's strategy, too. I think that's the way forward, because I'm going to be a little bit frustrated if I'm constantly waiting for them to put all this stuff together. And I think we can tell there's just a great need for a greater consciousness of the linkage of these issues.
Let me ask, we do these dialogues. We've done 50 since COVID. There is a hunger for what we're talking about here. We have had 200,000 people sign up and come or listen to our work. And one of the things we've learned to do, aside from no speeches, is at the end, we always say, what is one thing that people who are watching, people who are here, can do? So I would ask each of you, what is one thing to, what should, if people buy what you're saying, what is the next step? Marching on the bishops, getting young people to talk, moving forward. What's one thing? Let's start with Bill and with Aaron.
Well, this is a tall order, but this really is an existential issue. And the theme, the aim in Laudato Si and in other efforts on this is summed up in the phrase ecological conversion. And that requires taking a leap, but that's the most important thing that all of us need to do.
Patricia?
I actually agree with what Bill said. So I'll just add to that. A conversion means that a conversion sometimes requires sacrificing. Sacrificing something that is dear to you, convenient to you, for the sake of the greater good, humanity.
I would encourage people to link up with the Catholic Climate Covenant. I'm a believer in organizations and that we don't do things as well by ourselves. So great resources, and that's what I would encourage you.
I'm going to go for three things.
Way to go.
If you're not already supplying your home with 100% renewable energy, call your utility and make arrangements to do so. That sends a market signal that consumers want renewable energy, and it lets you feel good about what's powering your home. Think of what is the largest and most powerful organization to which you belong and begin a conversation about divestment with that organization. Hugely important to interrupt the moral power of fossil fuel organizations. Why should they be legitimized in their ongoing destruction of the planet? Start the conversation. And third, visit theletterfilm.org of the Laudato Si movement and invite your family, friends, colleagues, parish, congregation, community to watch this incredible new film starring the Pope, starring indigenous leaders, starring young people, starring an amazing climate refugee. Begin that conversation that we all need to have. So theletterfilm.org. Thank you, John.
My last piece of advice comes from a friend and supporter of the initiative, Mark Shields, who just passed away. He said, you can tell the health of an organization by whether they're looking for converts or heretics. On this issue, I'm a convert. We need more converts. And the only way we're going to do it is with these ideas, with these leaders, these programs, but relationships. I think it's usually not wise to end a session by quoting something, but there is one voice we really haven't heard explicitly, and it's the voice of Father Drew. And so I'm going to read just a few sentences from Renewing the Earth. The reason I can tell that it was written by Father Drew is it quotes Gerard Manley Hopkins. So none of the bishops said, I think we really need a quote from Gerard Manley Hopkins here. But let me just read this. And before I do, let me thank these four people. And I thank you for coming. But they have given us great, great insight, great passion, real eloquence, and a lot of hope. And what I'm going to, why don't we give a round of applause to these folks. And what I'm going to conclude with is the end of Renewing the Earth. If you want some hope, read Renewing the Earth and read the climate change documents. That's us. A just and sustainable society and world are not an optional ideal, but a moral and practical necessity. Without justice, a sustainable economy will be beyond reach. Without an ecologically responsible world economy, justice will be unachievable. To accomplish either is an enormous task. Together, they seem overwhelming. But all things are possible to those who hope in God. Hope is the virtue at the heart of a Christian environmental ethic. Hope gives us courage, direction, and energy required for this arduous common endeavor. Saving the planet will demand long and sometimes sacrificial commitment. It will require continued revision of our political habits, restructuring economic institutions, reshaping society, and nurturing global community. But we can propose with hope, because at the dawn of creation, so today, the Holy Spirit breathes new life into all Earth's creatures. Today we pray with new conviction and concern for all God's creation. Send forth thy Spirit, Lord, and renew the face of the earth. Thank you very much.